But basically, as he said, you know, I like to start on any discussion, any kind of presentation, have you, with introductions. As you know, my name is Nicholas Reed. I work for Ameren. I worked for Ameren for about 4 years. I'm in their system protection slash relay group. I basically design all the wiring for circuit breakers. I program relays that control circuit breakers. Chances are, if your lights go off, not here in Springfield, but if your lights go off and you live outside Springfield, it's probably a relay or something that I've set. I don't want to bore you too much with what I do. I do like to include a little bit about my personal life. I do have 2 kids. I have a little girl, 2 years old. I have a boy, 5 years old. I'm 28 years old. Tomorrow, I take the PE test. I don't know if you guys know what that is. Hopefully in June, July, I'll be a PE, just like Jack. Like I said, you gotta have, in order to take that test, you gotta be graduated from an ABET accredited university. And you have to have 4 years of working experience if you have a bachelor's degree, 3 years of working experience if you have a master's degree. With that, I don't know who any of you are. I've kind of talked to some of you a little bit, so I'll usually like to go around the room. If you could tell me who you are, if you could tell me what your major is here at the college, and if you could tell me kind of what job and career you guys are wanting to get after school. So I think it's only fair, ladies first.
I'm Cassidy. I'm an electrical engineering major. Still, like, just now hearing about all the options. I'm Natalie, civil engineer. Right now, I'm actually a project manager for DMA, so the construction now, planning, going structural engineer, hopefully, take my PE and do more design than anything.
I'm Mark, I'm an electrical engineering major, and I'm computer circle. What career path will I choose? I have a thinking power this year, but a set of self-defense
power. One thing I'll say, coming from, you know, electric engineering background and me coming from the power background, it's kind of by default, the power company, well, the power company here in Springfield is CWLP. They're a municipality, they're part of the government, basically. They're a monopoly. It's not like you can go from one company to the next company to get your power. Same thing with Ameren. You leave Springfield pretty much from I-80, you know, up north, all the way down to just about Kentucky and then into Missouri is all Ameren. And so there are some co-ops and things in between there, but what I'm getting at is you know, with something that big, there's job security. There's some companies that you can work for that they can hire you. 6 months later, they'll lay you off because maybe production is slow or maybe business isn't going well. And so one pro to the power systems world is job stability. You know, I haven't even had a whimmer of layoffs or anything with the company that I work for. But anyway, looks like we have a room full of engineers, which that's good. We have 2 electrical engineers, that's even better. Nothing wrong with 2. They're very needed in our business as well. We have a civil group that does all of our foundations, all of our grading, any structures or towers or anything. Civil engineers take care of it. So they're a very needed part, you know, with this team, so to speak. But since there are engineers in this room, I know some of you probably already said it already. Have any of you looked into, I don't know what the requirements are as of late, it's been a while since I've taken it. But has any of you taken the FE?
Hold on, I don't want to pass it.
Have any of you looked into taking the FE?
I'm not sure.
I would say as soon as you fulfill the requirements. When I went to Carbondale, I think they said that you had to be a junior. I think a junior in the coursework. And then I believe that, I don't know if there was a credit hour, a certain amount of credit hours you had to have or what, but after that you could take the test. And I recommend you take that test sooner than later. I didn't go to Carbondale for my whole college career. I started out at the community college level. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Southern Illinois, but there's a, you go down 57, there's a town called Marion, and there's a town called Carbondale. That's where the university is, obviously. But there's dead in between Marion and Carbondale, there's a little community college called Johnny Logan, JALC. I started there, and I finished at SAU Carbondale. And when I went to Carbondale, they talked about the FE. And when I first came there, I thought, what the heck is that? What does that mean? I have no idea. I recommend that you look into that sooner than later, because that's kind of like a, I think it may have changed now, but when I took it, it was kind of a general, like FE stands for Fundamentals of Engineering. So it's basically everything you learn over your college career pertaining to engineering is on that test. And it is an 8-hour test. It is 4 hours in the morning, I think there's like an hour lunch, and then there's 4 hours in the afternoon. And so I like to say it's like a whole lot of hell, fire, and fury, because it'll give you a run for your money. But I took that before I graduated. I think I took that a year before I graduated, SIUC, and I passed it the first time. And then once I graduated school, I was like, I had such momentum, I'm like, okay, let me take the PE. Because the requirements for the PE is you have a bachelor's degree, and you have a bachelor's degree from an accredited university, and I guess it doesn't really matter if you're working or not yet, because unless if you meet that requirement of 4 years of working experience, you won't get it, but you can take the test early. But I took the test early and failed, because I didn't know enough about what I was doing yet, and so now I'm taking it again early tomorrow. I'll be in Champaign for that one. But nonetheless, I could go on and on about that, but my recommendation to you is knock those out, well, at least knock the FE out sooner than later, because as soon as you get your degree, you can file the paperwork with the IEPR, and you can basically become an EIT. And so that is a big step on your resume when it comes to working. You know, if you got two people, you know, maybe they're both 3.0s, 3.5 GPAs, you know, if one's got the EIT and one doesn't have it, the person with the EIT is going to get hired, because that's one more step closer towards the PE. Your ability to stamp prints. It's not such a big thing in the utility world, but if you go into the like, commercial world, where you work for a company, stamping, being the ability to stamp prints or the will to get the license to do that, employers like love that. They like to keep that up. And so my recommendation to you is if you haven't looked into it, look into it. Start studying for it. They sell practice exams for all of them, FE, PE, whatever. But okay, I don't want to waste too much time on that. The last thing I want to mention about school and life and whatnot is something that was kind of hard for me in the beginning was, you know, once you graduate school, I mean, ideally all of us would want to get a job, make money. That's the inevitable goal, make money, live comfortably, live life. And so another recommendation is when you, once you get close to graduating with your bachelor's, I mean, unless if your intent is to go for a master's degree, immediately, my suggestion is after the last year, that senior year, fourth year, fifth year, whatever, start looking for a job. I interviewed with where I work now, I think it was 8 months, 9 months before I graduated, and I had the job, I knew I had the job, probably the beginning of my last semester at SWC. So basically, my old boss, I got a new boss now, he basically told me that so long as I graduated, I had the job. So, you know, I've seen a lot of people wait till the last minute or wait till after they graduate to start interviewing. And I don't know about you, but you know, when I was finishing up school, I had loans on my back and I had credit cards and I had bills. And the idea is the sooner you start looking, the better the opportunity, or the, you know, faster you'll get a job. And the last thing you want to have on your resume is you graduated, you know, just be arbitrary, summer of 2017, and you didn't get a job till December of 2017. I don't know about you, but 6 months of no pay is going to hurt my wallet. But anyway, that wasn't what I was really getting at. What I was getting at is when you do start working, you probably haven't heard this from anybody, and I didn't really get a whole lot out of it from school. But you have to have a healthy work-life balance. Now, I mean, now what I mean is, you know, you got to be good at work, and you got to make sure that work stays at work. And then you got to be good at home. You got to make sure your home life stays at home. And you know, a good example is like in my first couple of years, I was working on some pretty intense projects, and you know, I would go home, go to bed at night, and I'd be thinking about these projects, and they'd be riling me up, stressing me out. You know, is it going to work? Is it going to trip off? Am I going to get fired, or what? There, you got to have a way to kind of manage your stress levels. You know, if stuff is going wrong at work, chances are you're going to bring it home. And if stuff is going wrong at home, chances are you're going to be thinking about it at work, and you're not going to be working at 100% capability. But that's enough of my life advice and whatnot. But basically, as Jack had said, today we're going to talk about transformers a little bit. Geez, they have two cameras on me. Put the heat on me. But basically, I'm going to talk about transformers. All of you have heard of transformers, correct? You know what they are. Have you used one today? Have any of you used a transformer today? That's my starting off question for you guys. Have you used a transformer today?
Did we use it in the project?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We built a converter and we used it there.
They all build a 5-volt power supply.
Basically, what I was going to get at is, I like to ask this question because regardless of whether you know it or not, but you're using a transformer just about everywhere you go. There's a transformer that powers your house. There's a transformer that powers this building. To charge your phone, the battery charger you plug in the wall has a transformer built into it. Your car uses ignition coils, which are basically transformers. It takes 12 volts to step it up to 50,000 volts to fire the spark plugs in your engine. Everywhere you go, there's a transformer, whether we understand that or realize that. They're everywhere. And so, basically, I just wanted to make sure everybody knows, like, without this, it's almost like, kind of going back to the story, you want to make sure there's certain things that you're here to do. And so, with that being said, I guess I was going to kind of start with a real basic example. I promised you guys that I'm not going to really break out the math too much for you today. I'm a conceptual guy. I like to explain ideas. If you can understand the idea, then you can run through the equation. And so, basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with a transformer, a single-phase transformer that basically every one of us have used, whether we know it or not. And so, I get to start coloring on the board now. And so basically, I'm sure all of you have seen the utility electric poles that are everywhere, right? Yes, no? This transformer here, basically, there's thousands of them out there. Just about every house or every couple houses is powered by one. Ameren or CWLP or whatever utility, they have certain preferences on what they distribute power at or what voltage they distribute power at. And one of the more common ones, at least one in some of the rural areas, is, as I would call it, 12 kV or 12,470 is the actual value, 12,470 volts. This here, this is a B-line-to-line. The line-to-line voltage itself, that's if you were to take, if you were to go from hot wire to hot wire, I'll explain a little bit more about that. As he explained to you, anything on three-phase yet, and I guess that's what I want to hear. Okay. Let me back up a little bit before I start doing some of the math in this. All power today is generated and distributed. I wouldn't say all of it, but most of it. All power today is generated and distributed. In a three-phase system, meaning you have three hot wires. Affectionately, we call it A phase, B phase, C phase. That's the industry standard. Most of the time you'll have a generator. It's usually far, far away. Usually they're big, ugly. They have big smokestacks. They make a lot of noise. And generally, it's not something you want next to your house. And so usually these are, in most cases, are far away. When I think in terms of, I live in Decatur. One of the big generating stations is in Clinton. It's a nuclear unit. And so that's by design to be far away. And that's kind of why and how transformers and power systems kind of work to get the power to our outlet, so to speak. And so all power today, I'm just going to make it real simple, is generated and transmitted in a three-phase system. Now, there is some high-voltage DC that's out there, but I'm not going to talk about that today. But for the sake of simplicity, we're going to make this a 12,470 kV generator. Okay. talk too much about generators, like I said, this is a step after transformers, but the big difference between transformers and generators and motors, transformer is a static device. It doesn't move. It has windings on it, it has a core on it. I brought a little one here to show you, I'll pass it around a little bit. All it does is sit there and power basically passes through it. And so, I don't want to call it a passive device, but a generator, motor, they work by either being spun or they spin. And so, motors are basically like transformers, but they're not static, they move. And so, that's about as basic as I can make the generators themselves. And so, I guess, let's see how much I want to break this down. When I say, you know, power is generated at 12,470 volts, that's basically, if you had a voltmeter, we've all seen a multimeter, voltmeter, you know, it's probes. If you had one that was rated at that voltage, because they don't really, they make ones that are like that, but you're not going to go to Ace Hardware or Canars to buy one. But basically, if you were to take a meter and you were to measure, you know, you take the red lead, you take the black lead here, going from line to line is going to be 12,000. The potential difference between these two conductors is going to be 12,470. For the sake of this example, this generator here is going to be a it's going to be a synchronous machine, and it's going to be a the windings are going to be in a Y arrangement. Now, when I say a Y arrangement, there's basically, when it comes to motors, lows, generators, there's two types of winding configurations. There's Y, which I'll show you this, or as it was referred to in my undergrad, as a star connector. And so, in this case, we're going to have, you know, our three-phase conductors, and we're going to have a neutral conductor. So basically, this is known as a three-phase, four-wire system. And self-explanatory wiring, you got one, two, three, four wires, you got three phases. And so now, when you see, typically you won't have a generator really close to your house, but just for the sake of this example, I'm going to make it pretty simple. Usually what you'll have is you'll have a pole. I'm just going to do kind of something real simple here. We've all seen these poles, they're everywhere. There's nothing new about them. I mean, usually you'll have your pole, you'll have a cross arm, and you'll see wires sitting on top of insulators, and then you'll see like a neutral conductor. And usually what you'll have is you'll have your phase conductors up here, you know, this could be A, B, C, and this could be your neutral, or however they built it. Sometimes they take a single phase of wire, and they'll run it by itself. It's just dependent on what, you know, that area of town or whatever needs. You know, most residential customers are served off of just one of these phases. And kind of I'll show you once we get into that transformer a little bit more. But nonetheless, we take, you know, just for simplicity, we take our A-phase conductor here. We feed it into the, let's just call this the H1 bushing of our transformer. We take the other, the bottom of that line, which usually on a transformer of this nature, usually it's grounded to the case. And I hook this up. And so now, basically, we have a complete circuit. The thing to note, since we're not going from line to line anymore, we are going from line to ground. And due to the relationship between now, mind you, if there's something you don't understand, ask me. I've seen this so many times that it's honestly painful, but it's very simple for me. If I don't explain it in a way that's understandable, let me know. I'm a friendly guy, I don't fight. On a three-phase system, I guess I could back it more a little bit. You know, you have three phases. Each phase, you know, in a power system, the magnitude of the voltage is going to be the same per design. So in this case, you know, each of these, I could call this value here V-line line. There is such a thing as V-line to ground or V-line to neutral. this value here is basically VLL divided by the square root of 3. For this example, it makes it pretty easy. The numbers are pretty easy. If you take 12,470 and divide it by square root of 3, you get 7,200 volts. That winding in that transformer is going to see 7,200 volts on high side or the primary winding, so to speak. To get back to my little phasor diagram, I'm kind of jumping around a little bit. I'm trying to give you a little bit of background into it. Because all this stuff is kind of basic for me, but it's maybe new for you guys. On a three-phase system, the idea, at least in theory, is to have three equal voltages and to have a balanced load on your generator. I mean, you don't want like 100 amps on this one, you don't want like 150 amps on this one, and like 200 amps on that one. The idea is that this generator puts out constant power, and the loads on these phases are balanced. Now, how the utility does that at the distribution level is a little bit confusing. If we have time, later, I will explain some more of it, how some of that's done. Because my idea today is to kind of talk about transformers, and then I want to lead into how we use them at Ameren or at the power utility, so to speak. Is all this kind of making sense so far? I'm kind of trying to go a little bit fast. I know this is what we're here till 7, so we have about an hour.
6:20 or 6:50.
6:50, so 50 minutes. Okay. Basically, these three voltages that are generated by this generator. The voltage value is equal in magnitude, but it's separated by 120 degrees. So like say, in this case, we'll say, this phasor here, VA, we're going to say the voltage, we'll just call it VM, for the sake of simplicity, we're just going to say VM is an arbitrary number, angle 0. You guys know, are you guys familiar with polar coordinates? So you have a magnitude and you have a direction. And it's basically, you take a circle 360 degrees, and this is basically your direction of your phasor, so to speak. And so in a power system, we always call the three phases A, B, C. It's kind of an ANSI standard, American standard. A phase is always the reference phase, which means that A phase is always going to be 0. That's going to be the kind of point that we fix, and everything else is going to kind of be arbitrary, so to speak. And so that's our reference point. And when you look at these on a power system, when you draw this phasor diagram of your three, in this case, three voltage phasors, this diagram here, I mean, obviously, as you know, being an alternating current, it's a sine wave. And so with time, it's basically going up and down, up and down. At any given time, it can be anywhere. And so this diagram here rotates counterclockwise like this, okay? And this kind of deals with another interesting topic, the phase sequence. And so we have VA here, we have VB here, which we're going to say, VM angle minus 120. And then here we're going to say VC, which is going to be VM. And then since that's 0, that's minus 120, this one's going to be positive 120. And so basically now we have three phasors. We've got VA going this way at 0 degrees, 120 for VC, and then VB at minus 120. And so if you take this fixed point, what is this, our x-axis here, and so now you start rotating this thing. The first phase that hits the x-axis is A phase. Rotated 120 degrees, the next phase that hits is B phase. You go another 120 degrees, the next phase that hits is C phase. This is called the positive sequence rotation. And so now if I were to, I will tell you all the generators that are on, maybe Jack can correct me here, all the generators that I know of are all positive sequence generators, meaning this is the phase rotation phase diagram I'm gonna draw for you, which is a negative sequence rotation. And basically, it is the exact same as this. And as I mentioned, you know, A, that's our reference point. That never changes. We roll B and C. And I'll go ahead and draw that out. I got some room over here. So now, in this particular sequence, you know, if you rotate this phasor diagram counterclockwise, like we've been talking, you'll have a ACB rotation. Self-explanatory. And I'm not gonna write this here, this is the negative sequence rotation. You may ask me, why is this important? Why do you care? Utilities care about this a lot. It's very important. But like I said, there's no generators out there that are negative sequence generators. There's only positive sequence generators out there. Our low current is a positive sequence. The reason why it's important, you know, say you have two sources, like if we go up here. Source one, and then you have like source two, which this happens all the time in the utility system, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a generator. It could be a transformer, you know, from one utility or from one area to the next, and you cannot connect a generator or a source that's positive sequence to a generator or a source that's negative sequence. It just doesn't work. And the other thing, too, to mention is that if you're to parallel two sources, the phasing has to be equal. Otherwise, it's basically, you know, if you take A phase from one source and you go to B phase or C phase to the other source, it's basically a fault. And so when it comes to paralleling sources or networks or areas, this is very important. But this is kind of some foundation work. When I worked this problem out, it was kind of easy to me, but some of this stuff kind of helps to understand because when I hooked that transformer up at 7200 volts, you guys were like, how the hell did I get 7200 volts from 12,470? And so if we get back to our problem here, basically, you know, we have line-to-line voltage of 12,470. This particular transformer here is a single-phase transformer. This transformer, you know, it doesn't care about the other two B and C phases. All it's looking at is, you know, A phase and neutral. And that completes the circuit for it to work. And so let me draw a little bit more here.
Yeah, just a fun fact for you. I've seen pictures of generators that have been closed in, out of phase, where you close in a negative sequence source with a positive sequence source, and it'll literally rip the generator apart. It'll destroy it and shear the bolts and everything. And it sometimes happens by somebody mistakenly getting the phase rotation wrong. And there's other consequences to it in our world as relay engineers. If we don't have the right phase sequence, our relays won't work correctly. It's very important for us because we're looking at voltage and current, and we have to take those quantities into our measuring devices and make decisions on it. So we have to first know what we're looking at before we can do our settings.
Okay. Now, on this particular transformer, I said this is one that powers your house, so typically on a transformer that you see, what voltages do you see in your house? basically what you have is, you have your primary winding, which this is the 7200 volt winding. And then you have a winding, from top of the winding to bottom of the winding is literally, I guess I can pull up this. Oh, down here, you know, Arthur. You've got me this far. From top of the winding to bottom of the winding is 240 volts. Now, there's a center tap on this winding, and usually, it's tapped on the middle. And if you go from, for the sake of simplicity on this one, I'm gonna call this top leg, line one. I'm gonna call this center leg, neutral. And I'm gonna call this bottom leg, line two. You guys have seen the transformer like this. Jack, have you worked a single phase transformer? I'm sure you've worked plenty of these, haven't you already?
Yep. Okay. Yeah, and they have a couple examples in the book.
Okay.
That talk about that.
Basically, you know, you have this, it's almost like a two-winding secondary, so to speak. And so you have the top leg, line one, the center leg, neutral, and the bottom leg, line two. And so from line one to line two, you have 240 volts. From line one to neutral, you have 120 volts. You know, the same thing from here. You have line one to neutral, 120, and if you go from line two to neutral, you have 120. And so, this transformer here, basically, you will see this on just about almost any household service. This is what supplies the service interest to just about any house. If it's an apartment building or something else, they'll use a bigger version or a pad-mounted version, but usually this particular transformer is what you see hanging on your pole. And to kind of do a little bit of math here, we all remember this, don't we? Does that look familiar to you guys? Have you seen that equation before? This particular equation, basically, the relationship to understand about transformers is, maybe I should have said this in the beginning. When it comes to transformers, you're in the book, there's ideal transformers, which means that there's basically everything is perfect and no losses and everything else. In the real world, there's losses and there's other things that you have to take into account. But usually, when it comes to a transformer, you take the primary side. Usually, power in is equal to power out minus power losses. And those could be excitation current, that could be I squared R copper losses. But for the most part, transformers are very efficient. And does anybody know the reason why they're very efficient? I said it earlier when I was talking about motors versus transformers. Usually, like on a transformer, you can see 95%+ efficiency. When it comes to a motor, you see what, 80-85%. The reason for that is the transformer doesn't move; it's static. When you think about like a motor or a machine generator, it's got a spin, so it's got a shaft, it's got a rotor. That shaft is on bearings. There's friction in those bearings. The actual rotor itself has air drag as it spins, and those are things that cannot be, they can't make them any better than they already are. They can put high quality, low friction bearings in them. They're not going to be able to do anything about the air that spins around the rotor, so to speak. But the reason why transformers are so efficient is because they don't move, they're a static device. And so with no movement, the efficiency goes way up. So for this example here, does anybody know the typical size of like an AC panel in a house? Your house, my house?
I did say that last class, I think.
Do you guys remember? 200 amp. No. Any guesses? 100
amp.
Might be a good test question, I think.
That'd be a fire. Basically, the standard panel in residential installations can vary. The most common one that I've seen over the years is a 100 amp panel. I've seen them be as small as 50 amps, and I've seen them be as big as 200 amps, which is what's in my house right now. But for the sake of this example here. Basically, what we're gonna do is, this will be the hardest math that you guys do all day, so thank me later. We have this equation. This equation basically relates the voltage and currents from the high side to the low side. We know VP, we know VS, and when I say VS, I want the full winding here, okay? So now, you know, we have four unknowns, so okay, now we have three unknowns, now we have two unknowns, and so now, if I say that IP is equal to 3.5 amps, meaning you got 3.5 amps coming down A phase from the generator into this transformer, can you guys calculate for me what IS is going to be? When you find out, don't blur it yet. Let's have everybody get a chance to work this one. So let me write it up here. So I had many professors and instructors, and GAs over the years tell me units will guide you through your problems. I'm sure you've heard that. I had a chemistry teacher that loved to preach that to us. And so power in this instance we have, you know, like I said, power in is equal to power out. We're getting more losses for now. You have voltage times current. So your unit for power, here you got VA, volt amps. So now, this is a simple product. You can get, I mean, you plug it in your calculator, figure that one out. And then in order to get IS by itself, you divide 240 on both sides. So what is the, I mean, I just gave it to you. What is the IS secondary? I kind of almost said it when I asked you what the size of the normal panel is. Does everybody have an answer? And so basically, as you can see, this kind of illustrates my next point. So we'll put that here. You can see on the secondary side of this transformer, you have 105 amps at 240 volts. On the primary side, you have 7,200 volts at 3.5 amps. Did you guys see what happened there? Basically, what we did was, this is something that many professors over the years drew for me, and it kind of like helped me understand what's going on here. So basically what we did was we took the voltage, the volts, and we stepped it down, okay? And we took the current, amps. And we stepped it up. This is kind of one of the main reasons why transformers are used on power systems. Now you imagine your house, or an arbitrary house, takes 105 amps. Now, mind you, not everything in your house is going to be on at the same time. That's a whole other kind of concept. That's the concept of coincidized load or load diversity. But basically, if you can imagine, every house can pull 105 amps. So now you're talking, okay, you got my house, that's 100 amps, you got my neighbor's house, that's 200 amps, you got the next guy's house, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900 amps. Have all of you heard of the American wire gauge, or seen it, or looked at it? You know, the ampacity charts for sizes of wire conductors, is that something you guys looked at, seen, heard of? Basically, there's a chart out there that publishes wire sizes, and what they can conduct safely without burning up or heating, starting a fire. Could you imagine the, now if we talk one street, let's say, let's take 10 houses. If you were to distribute electricity at 240 volts, every house would need 100 amps. Can you imagine the size of the wire that it would take to carry 1,000 amps to just one street? It'd be huge. We're talking a conductor that's probably the size of a fire hose or better. And so basically that brings me kind of to my next point. In a power system, because of transformers that gives us this capability, the higher the voltage is, the more we can reduce that current. So basically, you know, as we distribute power, you know, your house is only taking 3.5 amps off that wire, which in the grand scheme of things, that's nothing. But the biggest thing is that when we distribute power, we want to minimize losses. Specifically, here's one that if you're for the electrical engineers in here, copper losses, which we typically define as I squared R, and it's power lost, and it's in watts, and basically, you know, say, you know, take me, you know, I work for Ameren, you know, we don't own generators, we buy power from the generators, and then we sell it to you guys at the same price, but if I buy 1,000 megawatts of power, then I got to distribute it through all my wires and transformers. Every device has losses in it, whether that be a line, whether that be a transformer. By the time I get through my whole power system, there's going to be a lot of losses. And so basically that 1,000 megawatts that I bought is basically going to be, you know, 1,000 megawatts minus all the losses. And so for me, that would be money lost. And so if I'm losing money bringing power to you guys, I'm going to try and reduce my losses as much as I can, because, you know, that's more money in my pocket at the end of the day than the utility's pocket. And so, as you can see, copper loss is I squared times R, which is, you know, the resistance of the conductor. So now, if we go back to my little example, you know, I live on a street that's called Logan Street. So if Logan Street has 10 houses, 240, that are served by a 240 service, each house is 100 amps, you know, I got 1,000 amps, I've got to go. I can take 1,000 times, or I can take 1,000, I can square it, and then I can multiply it by the resistance of that conductor. I have like tons of losses, like I lost like lots of power. And so the idea is now, if I take, okay, so in this example, I'm just rounding this off to 100, so that was 1,000. And so you take this, 10 times 3, so 30 amps. So what's going to have more losses? Am I going to have more losses, you know, at 240? volts, or am I going to have more losses at 7200 volts? Does that question make sense? You guys know the answer? Which voltage is going to give me more losses? Yes. And the reason for that is the current is so high. I mean, power, you know, power through a transformer, like the power in is equal to power out. And so all it's doing is it's changing the voltage and it's changing the current. And the idea behind it, the reason why we want it, is we can either make voltage really high to make the current really low to reduce our I squared R losses. And then when we get to an industrial customer, a residential customer, we can step it down to whatever voltage we want. You know, the industry standard for residential is 120-240. Industrial, they can be served from 277-480 all the way up to Caterpillar and Decatur has a service entrance of 138,000 volts. So it all depends on the customer or what, but this particular device gives us the ability to change the voltage and to reduce losses, kind of one, you know, kind of sealed the package. Does all this make sense so far? I'm trying to pace myself. I go on and on about this. I'm a nerd when it comes to this stuff. This makes me like really like excited. But now the idea is this is a single phase transformer. You know, if we look at our generator, you know, it's putting out three phases. And so, you know, say in this case, you know, we have a generator, I'm gonna use Decatur for example. The closest generator that I know of is at Clinton's, the nuclear station in Clinton. It's roughly, I don't know, 25 miles north of Decatur. It's big, it's noisy, there's steam and noise and crap that I don't want next to my house. Can you imagine if you take, if we take this copper loss idea, and not only do you have a lot of current you gotta move, or power you gotta move, but now, I mean, now you're subjected to a really, 20 miles is long, but you know, if you think about like an extension cord, you know, 100 feet or something, 20 miles versus 100 feet is a lot. And so this value here is gonna start adding up, you know, further away. So the idea is the smaller we can make the resistance, which that's a whole other topic on conductors, conductor sizes and capacities, and the smaller we can make the current. And so now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this idea here and I'm gonna apply it to a three-phase transformer, because we move power. When we pass power, when we transmit power, when we distribute power, whether it be at the transmission level or the sub-transmission level or a lot of our distribution substations, it is all three-phase. We don't just pull one phase off and run with it for 100 miles, although some legacy companies did that. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to, in fact, I think I'm going to get a volunteer for this one. Taking that idea there,
Nick, you got about 25 minutes left. Did you want to show some pictures and
let's see if this thing?
I just didn't know if you wanted to prioritize. You don't got a lot of time left.
Yeah, this, like you said, it's passed by really fast. This let's see here. Did this work?
Dylan. Did you want to introduce yourself and kind of talk about your major? And
I'm done with that. I think I'm going to go into civil engineering. So I'll be done at Edisville next fall. So I'll transfer from here.
So we got everybody in here who's going to Edwardsville, which is where I went to school.
That makes for a very happy instructor. I'm the lone farm guy here. But I'm also the lone guy that's from the far south suburb of Chicago, too, so my drive is 5 hours to school. I don't think this is going to work, to be honest with you. This thing here, it wants me to install Citrix, and Citrix is hosed. I can, however, I'll make one last attempt while it does that. This is a single-phase transformer. Basically what it is it's got a two-window core. The core looks like this. And so basically you have two windings on this particular unit here. You have a basically, you have a winding. You know, if you were to look at this from a bird's eye view, like if I was like to stare down at it, basically you have the core, you took a cutaway of it, and you have a winding here, and you have another winding outside of it. Okay, that's just how this particular transformer is. Basically, you have an inside winding and you have an outside winding. Usually, the inside winding is the secondary winding, which is the lower voltage winding. And the reason for that is it's closer to the core. And they want the higher voltage to be further away. It's for insulation purposes. But basically, this transformer here, it's not the same voltage as this one, but it's identical. It's an identical winding arrangement for this one. Basically, what it does is, I'll pass around two things here. It takes in 120 on the primary side. You got two wires going into it, and you got three wires coming out of it. This particular transformer, you know, it has line one, line two, and then the green with the yellow stripe on it's the neutral wire. And here's the nameplate, but I don't know if you guys want to pass this around. Let me see if I can get some pictures here. Maybe I should have brought my computer, is what I should have did.
If you can't get that to work, I can show them during the next class some pictures somehow.
I could probably burn them to a disk, and you could probably bring them here and show them.
Yeah, figure out something.
I had some wonderful pictures of some huge, we buy off all of our distribution transformers from a company called ABB. I'm sure you guys have heard of them before. They are big into just about everything. But I had some cool pictures of a transformer core being put together, how they build the linings, how they stack the blocking material together. I'm kind of sad now that I don't get to show you guys that. But, I work with him every day, so I will send it with him in the next class period. You guys can see those pictures and he can explain to you. What I want to do in the last 20 minutes or so is I want to take the idea of a single phase transformer and I want to kind of extrapolate that to a three phase transformer. And so, in doing so, let me erase this stuff here.
Yeah, you do have access to the internet where you can pull up pictures with the Google search too if you wanted to do some of that to illustrate.
I can show you. I was just going to pull up a substation transformer and show you. I've got a picture on my phone. I can show you before we leave. Last year, I put in a two of them. It was a step down transformer, three phase, 138,000 volt, 69,000 volt transformer. It was 168 MVA. If it was all real power, it would be 168 million watts. And me standing next to this transformer. It is like the size of a house, or better. I'll show you a picture of that. I've got a picture of my phone. If I had an email account, I would pull that one up. But basically, while that's doing that, what we'll do here is throwing loose. Right? Do I have any volunteers here? I've got three of you. The fourth one ran off. Being that I kind of gave you part of it there. If we kind of draw the line like right here, like I continue, this is my, I just call it A phase, and then B phase, and then C phase. And then I will be nice and start it off. What I want one of you to do is I want you to show me the following that convention there, which that's pretty much like a Y convention. Show me how you would connect a three-phase bank. All the high side linings to the primary conductors. I'd like to see somebody do that. Do I have any volunteers? Let your crickets speaking. Screaming. Anybody? Nobody? Okay. I'd ask him to do it, but I know he would do it, right? Nonetheless, I'll do it. Like I said, when it comes to transformers, generators, or loads, there's two types of line connections you can have. There's a Y connection or a delta connection. For simplicity, I'm going to just draw the Y connection because the delta connection might make you distract your guys a little bit. It's a little more confusing. But basically, in the olden days, when a utility needed a transformer, the technology wasn't there to build just a big, like you see in this picture here. Basically, all the transformers that you see here, I mean, you can look it up on Google, Titan's three-phase substation transformer or substation transformer. It's a single tank, meaning you have one gigantic tank, you have one core, and you have pretty much, unless if it's an auto or something weird, you have six windings. You have three high-side windings and you have three low-side windings. The most common type of core used in those types of transformers is this core. There's two types of core types. There's what's called a core type and there's what's called a shell type. The core type looks like this. The shell type is basically a vertical representation of this. They used to use those years ago, but they're just too big, too tall to use today. They use this type of core arrangement. But back to my point, utilities years ago, they would use three single-phase transformers to make a three-phase bank. In fact, I replaced one of them last year that was there for almost 90 years in one of the substations. But basically, you could take that idea there, and I'm using relatively low voltage numbers, but basically you can just extrapolate it. You can say, okay, you know, I've got three separate transformers here, and so we'll make that the neutral conductor. And so basically, to draw this circuit out, I'm just going to go, I'm going to have one phase go to each transformer. I'm going to have the bottoms of each winding. And that's basically, that's as simple as it gets. That's a Y connection. Y or star connected, in this case, high side. Does anybody want to draw the secondary side for me? That's the reflection of the... Anybody?
No? Just call on somebody. See if somebody will... Does anybody want to do it?
I'll call on you. Come up here and draw it out for me. Basically, what I want you to do is I want you to, in a Y fashion, I want you to draw the low side windings. Now, this is your high side, this is your 12470 side. And in this case, just for the sake of simplicity, since we did a 120-240 transformer there, I want you to draw either Y connected low side. Does that make sense?
On this side or something?
Yes. Yes. Basically, what you got is you have the low side of the transformer. Low side or secondary side, and this side here is the primary side, or high voltage side. Will this confuse you even more? It's basically the same thing as the other side.
Can I just go A, B, C, and then just the like the progression?
It is. Since I made you draw it, you'll never forget ever again how to do a Y-Y transformer.
Mm-hmm.
Good job, Jim.
I got a lot of stuff. Basically, you know, what we took here was, we took a single-phase transformer and we applied it to a three-phase system. Like I mentioned, years ago, utilities would use single-phase transformers and they could make a three-phase bank from three single-phase banks. In today's world, all the transformers look like this. It's a single tank, it's a three-phase, single transformer. Like I said, it's got six windings in it. It's got three high-side windings, three low-side windings. The core of the transformer, the iron core, wherever that one is, it's a two-window core, and so basically you'll have the phase A windings here, you'll have the B phase windings here, you'll have the C phase windings here, so you'll have coils here, you know, same in the center, and if you had a bird's eye view, each actual center post, so to speak, you'll have the low voltage winding on the inside, you'll have the high voltage winding on the outside, and the reason for that was because of insulation purposes. You know, in the case if you have, you know, and maybe at this voltage or even that guy right there, the placement of the windings isn't as critical, but if you get into a higher voltage substation or higher voltage power system, like the example I did was the one that I put in last year, you know, this is 138,000 volts, 138 kV, and this was 69,000 volts. I don't know about you, but that's a lot of voltage. And basically, the higher the voltage, the further you want it away from anything conductive, because you know otherwise it'd be more susceptible to a fault or a flash over or an arc or anything. But basically, you know, this is the idea behind it. The beautiful thing about YY transformers, when you talk about phasers, which I could draw them out, but I don't know if I got a lot of time, but there is no phase shift between the high side and the low side. I had it here, I think it was in your guys' book. This is on page 399 of the book. This basically shows you the different types of connections, the source and load. A Y is going to be representative of Y. A triangle is going to be representative of a delta. And so you have four configurations here. There's more out there depending on the winding type. You know, when you talk about a YY transformer, typically when we install one of those, it's an auto transformer, which means it's got basically, it's got one winding per phase, so instead of being six windings, it's got three windings, but I'm not going to confuse you today on that. So basically, this transformer here that we drew is a YY. Like I said, the beautiful thing about this, you basically almost take a single phase representation, and you basically extrapolate that, it's like modular almost, you just apply it to the other two phases. And there's no phase shift from high side to low side. All you have is you have the voltage and the current transformation that happens in the transformer itself. Same thing with the delta. If you had a delta connection, there is no phase shift. When you have a delta high side and a delta low side, I don't see too well. There is a transformer that I have a project down in one of them right now that is a delta-delta. So they do exist, but they're rare. The more common units that are out there are, most of what we install usually is a delta-Y transformer. And whenever you go from a delta connection to a Y connection or a Y connection to a delta connection, there is a phase shift along the voltage transformation and the current transformation. So, like if you were to draw the phasers of this particular transformer here, just to be simple, you know, and let's just extrapolate from what I drew over there. You know, you have A phase, B phase, C phase. The phasers on this side, you know, the VM in this case here is going to be, you know, 12, 470, angle 0, 12, 470, angle minus 120, 12, 470. Angle 120. And then if you were to draw the phasers here for the low side, it's going to be the same thing. The angles are going to be the same, but the voltages are going to be different. And in this case here, if you were to take any of these phase conductors, being that I said that this was a 12470 on the high side, the phase transformation is a little bit different when you have three transformers versus You got the single phase transformer you have here. This transformer here, they refer to it as a single phase transformer, but it's also referred to as a split phase transformer. And the reason for that is that if you were to take an oscilloscope and you were to measure line one versus line two, they're 180 degrees off from each other. So it basically takes one phase and it splits it into two that are 180 degrees apart. This here, you know, if you were to take any of these conductors and go to ground, or I should say neutral, you're going to get 120 volts. If you go any of these conductors to themselves, so VA to VB, you're going to get, you'd think with that transformer you'd get 240, but you're not, you're going to get 208. And it's just with that split phase transformer, line one and line two are 180 degrees apart. On this particular unit here, line one, which we could call it A phase, line two, we could call it B phase, they're 120 degrees apart. So the phase difference isn't as much as you'd see on a transformer like that. So you'd get 208, and then you know, you went from here to here, you get 208, and then any of them to ground, you get 120 volts. And so in this case here, you know, each phase is going to be 120, angle zero, 120, angle minus 120, that's kind of weird, 120, positive 120. And so as you can see, the phasor diagram, I think there's one in your guys' book. I think I'm running out of time here, but maybe it's in my power system book. Oh yeah, it's right there. Basically, the phasors are, you know, basically all you did was you step the voltage down. The phasors are in line with themselves. Now, if you were to take a delta connection, there'd be a 3-degree shift. Now, depending on how the windings, how the windings are connected on the delta side, you know, it can lead to lag. Because they basically, the ANSI standard is for the high, in a delta Y transformer, the high side leads the low side by 30 degrees. And in the interest of time, I've got 4 minutes. I'm going to draw you a delta connection real fast, and then I think I'm done. Common transformer that we put in our distribution substations is a delta Y transformer.
That's what I meant.
Delta grounded Y, I should say. And so, like now, if you remember from over there, the low side in this case, I'm going to say the low side of this transformer is 12470 kV, and I'm going to say the high side is 69,000 volts or 69 kV. And so, following that example here, the Y side's easy.
Gets you right.
We take the bottom of every winding and ground, and that becomes a neutral.
Good job.
And so you got your A phase, B phase, C phase. And so on the delta side, it's a little bit different now. In terms of phasors, we're actually going to be summing phasors here. And so instead of having them all individual, basically we're going to take the bottom of the A phase winding, connect it to the top of the B phase winding. We're going to take the bottom of the B phase winding, we're going to connect it to the top of the C phase winding. And then we're going to take the top of the A phase winding and we're going to connect it to the bottom of the C phase winding.
Yeah.
And so basically this will be our A phase. This connection, the top of the A phase winding to the bottom, or I'm sorry, the bottom of the A phase winding to the top of the B phase winding is going to be our B phase. And then the bottom of the B phase winding to the top of the C phase winding is going to be our C phase. And so this here is a delta Y transformer. There's various reasons why we use deltas. Two of the biggest reasons is this one, it traps zero sequence currents and it traps third harmonic currents. So basically it's like a it's like a sink for the harmonics. Harmonics can circulate in these delta lines, but they can't move. We love it as system protection engineers because in relaying purposes, when we look at certain relays to detect certain types of faults, ground current can't pass through this transformer because of that delta. And so that means any ground relaying on the low side will not interfere with anything on the high side. And so with that being said, if I were to draw you the phasers of this particular transformer, they're going to look something like this might throw you off a little bit because my X1 or my A phase is going to be pointing 180 degrees in the opposite direction. But basically, on transformers, on a three phase transformer, the high side bushings will get to the designation of H1, H2, H3. And I want you to notice that on the delta side, there's only three wires going to the transformer as opposed to on our Y high side, there was four wires coming into the transformer. And as you can see, high side, there'll be three wires, three bushings. Low side, there's going to be four wires, four bushings. And these will be affectionately called X1, X2, X3. And that could be, usually they call this one the XO bushing. And that's ANSI standard, American standard. That's how they label those. And then when we look at phasers here, H1, H2, H3, X1, X2, X3, X0. And so that, ladies and gentlemen, would be your phasers. And then to make it a little more simple, they usually draw like a fictitious neutral. To kind of give you an example, if we were to take these, and these phasor diagrams rotate just like the ones that I erased earlier. You know, this rotates like this, counterclockwise. You can see, as I mentioned, X1 bushing, which is going to be your A phase, is pointing pretty much 180 degrees, basically due left. And you can see the H1 bushing on the high side. If I draw it in there to kind of illustrate a little bit better, you can see that it's 180 degrees plus 30 degrees. And if I were to rotate this diagram counterclockwise, and you know, I had my fictitious 0 degree mark on the x-axis, the high side H1 bushing is going to hit the x-axis before the H1 bushing. So basically what that's saying is the high side leads the low side by 30 degrees. And so with that, I've run out of time. So I don't know if all this made sense to you. I mean, I've got more time to talk, but I don't want to confuse you anymore. But basically, we use transformers in power systems to, well, they do everything. I mean, I've only touched on the idea that we use them to transfer power. But, I mean, communications uses them, power systems use them. I mean, there's a book there that I have right there for maybe that illustrates several usages of transformers. But, I mean, they're basically everywhere. And so when somebody says, like, why do we need to know this? We use them every day. I mean, whether we're conscious of that fact or not, I would venture to say very few devices in your house, other than maybe the exception of motors, heaters, or ovens, actually use 120 or 240. Everything in your house, usually like when it goes to your phone, it gets stepped down. It goes through a transformer, steps down. You know, like in the case of the control circuit for your furnace, it's either a 12-volt or 24-volt control circuit, DC. And so it'll pass through a transformer, then it'll pass through a rectifier to convert it to DC. Your laptops, your phones, everything uses it. And so, to finish up, does anybody have any questions for me? Does everything seem like it was clear? I threw a lot of information out. To me, it's second nature. Does it license. That's basically it for today, unless you check, is there anything else to add?
No, thanks a lot for coming today, Nick, you did an excellent job, and we have a review Tuesday and then the test Thursday. I misspoke earlier, we got 2 weeks left of class and then we'll have the final. All right, free to go.